In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. Tomorrow is Laetare Sunday, and so I'm in the pink, and I'm offering Mass this evening for the repose of the soul of Mary Williams. My brothers and sisters, let us call to mind our sins, and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess that I have prayed in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my fault, and therefore I ask blessing Mary and the Virgin, all the angels and saints, and to you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Let us pray. O God, who through your word reconcile the human race to yourself in a wonderful way, grant, we pray, that with prompt devotion and eager faith, the Christian people may hasten toward the solemn celebrations to come. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Thanks be to God.
Oh, let my tongue cleave to my mouth, if I remember you not.
Oh, let my tongue cleave to my mouth, if I remember you not.
By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat and wept, remembering Zion. On the poplars that grew there, we hung up our harps.
Son of God. who believes that he is the Messiah, the one that has been promised for generations by the prophets of old. But because he is a Pharisee, he's not allowed to believe that. The other Pharisees have banned people from believing that Jesus is the Messiah. And so he comes to meet Jesus secretly at night, to have secret catechesis, as it were. And so if you want to truly understand the purpose of the Incarnation, why Jesus came, read the conversation between Jesus and Nicodemus. Everything you need to know is there. And so in the excerpt that we just heard, Jesus explains why he has to be put to death. And so he begins by saying that the Son of Man must be lifted up as Moses lifted up the serpent in the desert. I was hoping the first reading tonight would be that story, but for some reason it's not. So what Jesus is referring to is a time during the Exodus when the Israelites came to a part of the desert where there were lots of snakes, and people were being bitten by these snakes. And so God tells Moses to make a serpent on the top of a pole out of bronze. And whoever is bitten by one of these snakes just needs to look at the bronze serpent and they will be healed of the snake bite. And it's for this reason that to this day, the symbol for medicine is a snake wrapped around a pole. So Jesus says to Nicodemus, the Son of Man must be lifted up as Moses lifted up the serpent in the desert, so that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. And of course he's referring to the crucifixion itself, when he will be lifted up on the cross, and people will look at him. Even 2,000 years later, every time we come to church, it's exactly what we see. And then comes that famous phrase, God loved the world so much that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not be lost, but may have eternal life. Whoever believes that this moment, Jesus being lifted up on the cross, is essential. Whoever believes that it happened for a definite purpose will be given eternal life. For God sent his Son into the world not to condemn the world, but so that through him the world might be saved. No one who believes in him will be condemned, but whoever refuses to believe is condemned already, because he refused to believe in the name of God's only Son. This moment is a testing moment for everyone, from the very moment that it happened. When Jesus was in the garden, at the moment of his arrest, the disciples scattered. So it was only Our Lady, St. John, and the other women who were with him at the foot of the cross. The disciples were disheartened at this. This man they had been following for 3 years, this man they had been learning everything from, had been arrested and put to death by the authorities. What was the point in all of this? And so it wasn't until he rose from the dead that they began to believe. And that Sunday after Easter Sunday, the last of the disciples comes to believe, when he's told by the other 11 that Jesus has risen from the dead and they have seen him, and Thomas says, "No, I refuse to believe unless I see him myself, unless I can put my fingers into the holes in his hand, unless I can put my hand into the hole in his side, I refuse to believe." And then when Jesus does appear to him and offers to let him do as he wanted, he simply falls to his knees and says, "My Lord and my God." Tomorrow is Laetare Sunday. Tomorrow we rejoice because we are only 3 weeks away from Easter Sunday. Yes, we must go through what the disciples went through and see Jesus arrested in the garden on Thursday night. Yes, we must see him being lifted up on the cross. Yes, we must go through those 3 days when he is not with us. But on Easter Sunday he will rise from the dead. And what joy we will have in that. Because then these words that he spoke to Nicodemus will become fresh in our minds. And we will understand that all of that was for a purpose. All of that was so that those who believe in him may be saved. So then it is our duty, as it was the disciples, to make sure that people come to know what Jesus did for us. It is our duty to tell everyone we meet about these amazing events. And thank God that he became a human being. Thank the Father that he sent his Son into the world, that everyone who believes in him may not be lost, but may have eternal life.
So now let's stand and profess our faith together. I believe in one God, the Father, the Holy Spirit, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before the world was made, God from God, the light from God, the true faith and the true God, begotten of God. Please be seated.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that this, my sacrifice and yours, may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. We place before you with joy these offerings which bring eternal remedy, O Lord, praying that we may both faithfully revere them and present them to you as is fitting for the salvation of all the world, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. By the mystery of the Incarnation, he has led the human race that walked in darkness into the radiance of the faith, and has brought those born in slavery to ancient sin through the waters of regeneration to make them your adopted children. Therefore, all creatures of heaven and earth sing a new song in adoration, and we with all the host of angels cry out and without end acclaim, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord God of hosts. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith, we proclaim your death, O Lord. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your Church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Alan, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honour is yours, for ever and ever. At the Saviour's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign for ever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Lamb of God, behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, those who are joining us from home, we make an act of spiritual communion together. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you are already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. Thank you. Let us pray. O God, to enlighten everyone who comes into this world, illuminate our hearts, we pray, with the splendour of your grace, that we may always ponder what is worthy and pleasing to your majesty, and love you in all sincerity, through Christ our Lord. Please be seated for the notices. Our Lenten Reconciliation Service is this coming Tuesday, 16th of March at 7 p.m. It will only be available on Facebook Live. So you have 2 days to join Facebook and to send a friend request to the parish account, and you can join in with that. The order of service is available on the parish website. It's attached to the newsletter. Stations of the Cross are every Friday during Lent at 7 p.m. at Holy Trinity. And this Tuesday at 1:45 is the Requiem Mass for Margaret McGonagall. Now, Father Rick was mentioning that her family said there wouldn't be many people at it. He said that there would be 3 people there, but he wasn't sure whether that was just for when she's being received into the church on Monday evening, or if that's the funeral itself. Now, it'd be incredibly sad for such an amazing lady to have such a poorly attended funeral. So, if you are able to come to see Margaret's body being brought into the church on Monday afternoon. I can't remember off the top of my head what time it is, but it's in the newsletter, then please do. However, please be aware that only 30 people are allowed to attend. Also, if you are able to come to her Requiem Mass, then please do. But again, only 30 people are able to attend. So for both of those, please only come if it's not inconvenient for you to turn around and go back home again. I just want to have as many people to come to Margaret's funeral as possible. As I said, it'd be so sad for Margaret's funeral to be so poorly attended. So if it would be an inconvenience if you were to arrive and we were saying, I'm sorry, but there are too many people here, you'll have to go home, then don't worry at all. But if it's not so much of a convenience that might be a possibility, then please do come. We don't have any First Holy Communion families here with us this evening, do we? No. Wonderful. In which case, the Sacred Triduum and Easter morning. So on Maundy Thursday, there will be Mass at 8 p.m. at Holy Trinity. On Good Friday, the service of the Lord's Passion will be 3 o'clock here at St. Basil's. The Easter Vigil on Holy Saturday will be 8 p.m. at Holy Trinity. And then on Easter Sunday, there will be Mass here at St. Basil's at 12 o'clock. To attend any of these, you need to book by calling Sarah in the parish office. Now, Sarah was off for the last week, so if you have already phoned and left a voicemail message, she will be able to get back to you this week. But I get the impression that Father Rick didn't mention that last week. If you haven't yet, then please do give Sarah a call to book your place at any of those services. So other than that, have a lovely evening, a wonderful Sunday, especially any mums here. Tomorrow is Mother's Day. I will spoil rotten tomorrow. And have a fabulous week,
And I will see you again very soon. Please stand for the final blessing. The Lord be with you. Bow down for the blessing. Look upon those who call to you, O Lord, and sustain the weak. Give life in your unfailing light to those who walk in the shadow of death, and bring those rescued by your mercy from every evil to reach the highest good through Christ our Lord. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.